Okay, so this what she said basically means that I decline any responsibility, all right, about this presentation. So, okay, so I'm happy to be here in the Kernel Recipes, talking about a topic that is not related to the kernel at all. But I hope that maybe some of you will find this tool useful for your kernel work. I hope so. We will see. So first of all, Poke is not finished. Actually, I have not released the first version yet. I published the source code like 2 weeks ago after having worked on it for 2 years in the solitude of my house, let's say, all right? So basically, the source code has been public only for a couple of years, for a couple of weeks, and is not released yet. So please keep that in mind when you start using it and you make it crash. It's normal. It will crash often. So, what was my motivation of writing a general purpose binary editor? To not have to write stuff like this, right? In my daily job, I work on the GNU toolchain, like in GCC, binutils, whatever, and then I find myself very often in the need of poking at object files. In my case, it is ELF object files, usually, and other binary objects. Then I have like a private collection of scripts, which are horrible and do unspeakable things. Using things like that, like object dump to get, you know, like section information, parse it from the terminal, get the offset of the section, and then using DD finally to patch a couple of bytes or to get to fetch them. I hate this. I want to get rid of this stuff. So my motivation for doing this was, well, I need to edit object files. In my case, it is object files. In other people's case, it could be packaged in a network interface or process memories or whatever. I don't want to use those scripts which are depending on other utilities like the binutils in this case. So if the output of the format of object dump changes, then my scripts break, right? So then it was like, okay, let's write, you know, a general purpose binary editor. I mean, how difficult that could be, right? I mean, yeah, I remember having those things, you know, back in the 90s, you know, in DOS, you know, I mean, it should be easy. Well, initially, I was like, okay, I want to edit object files, binary files, but I want to edit binary files not in terms of bytes or bits or whatever, but in terms of structs that I can define on the binary file. Like, for example, in the case of ELF, object files, you have sections, you have relocations, you have stuff like that, right? So I needed something that I could use to define that struct, that structure. So I define the structure I want to use to operate on the binary file, and then I use my tool to operate in terms of those abstractions, like read this relocation, change this field of this relocation, things like that. So then I just started with C structs. But we all know that C structs are actually pretty bad when it comes to describe physical layout of data, right? Why? Because there is a lot that is implied by the compiler, it's undefined behavior. So it's up to the compiler, you know, about introducing padding or alignment or reordering your bit fields or whatever. So then I was like, okay, it should be like C structs plus something else. I wanted it to look like C because my main target of users, which is you, basically, well, it's mainly like C programmers, right? So I looked at some existing work. There is a nice one, which is called DataScript, which it was made by this person working in an American university in 2010 or so. It is nice, but I found it a bit not that much satisfactory because it was a bit short. I will explain a bit more about this in terms of expression power. And then there is something horrible called 010 editor, which is proprietary, and it tries to do something similar, but it uses the easy way. It basically has a C interpreter. So you can operate on the data structure. We will see that you need to have in your domain-specific language to define the data structure, you need more than what, I don't know, C or Python or any other language provides. So after a lot of, you know, of, months of design failures and implementing, and then it doesn't work, then I think I finally got it right. So this is poke, right? This is poke opening a file, a binary file, and using the dump command to give you a binary dump. Okay, it's not very impressive, right? I get it. So better than telling you what poke is, I'm gonna show you how I use it, okay? So it's demo time and segmentation fall time. Hopefully not, but most probably yes. So the demo is to poke a relocation in an object file. Oh, I got this from internet because I could not bring myself to draw it myself. Eh? Okay, disclaimer. But okay, ELF format file. Yeah, okay, there is a header, then the header has a pointer, is an offset in the file to a section header table, then there is a string table, and so on, right? It's a mess, you know? So how would you change, for example, the offset of a relocation in an object file? Because that is what we are going to do now. We are going to vandalize an ELF file using poke. So first, we need an object file. Let's see something like this. Fine. Then we are going to call poke to edit this file. There you go. So there is a command which is dump, which gives us, you know, like the dump of bytes, bits, whatever, you know, of the file. In poke, there is an operation which is mapping, which is basically that, oh, I want to know what is the integer at the offset, I don't know, 24 byte. Okay, well, it's boring, it's zero, whatever. Right? And poke implements its own full-fledged programming language. So you can do things like this, like def bar a in the integer at the offset 24 bytes. Okay. Also, in poke supports, you know, more complex types, so you can define a more complex struct. For example, you can define a type, def type, packet, which is a struct that contains an integer and then a long after it. And then you can also map structs. For example, what is the packet at the beginning of the file? It will be that. And then, of course, the same. You can do, you know, def bar p for packet, and then you can say, okay, p.i. And you can actually change it and assign a new value to it. But we are talking about ELF files, not about this simple example. So I wrote a little pickle to the files containing poke code. I call them pickles, which contains definitions of types which reflect the structure of an ELF file, of a subset of it. It's the subset I needed for this presentation, which is like 100 lines. Okay, so let's make poke aware of this with load. And okay, the first thing I need, I'm gonna rush through this because I don't have time. So I'm sorry if it is too quick, but what I want to express to show you is how it feels to use this, all right? I need an ELF header, which is at the beginning of the file. Okay, I have in my pickle a struct here, a type called ELF64EHDR for header, which contains, you know, some definitions of some fields or whatever. So I can map it. Where is the ELF header at the beginning of the file, right? So this is an ELF header. It's a struct, right? What happens if I try to map the ELF header starting at the second byte of the input output? I get a constant violation exception. Why? Because you can see here that in a poke description, when you describe a struct, you can define constraints. In this case, the ELF magic number. But this is just a detail. Okay. So let's put it in a variable, EHDR. So EHDR is my ELF header. So now I need to get the section header table, which is a section header table. So it is a table. It's a collection of things. What things? Section headers. I have in my pickle I have here the definition of how what a section header in ELF looks like. So I also map. What should I map? Section headers, but I need a collection of it. So it's an array. I can map arrays too. How many section headers I have in my ELF file? Well, it is contained in the ELF header called shnum. You see? At what offset? Where is the section header in an ELF file? It's also linked or expressed in the header. SH off. So this is okay. Map ESHNUM section headers, you know, from this offset, and we get it. Okay, this is horrible, right? Because it's an array of structs. Okay, we put it in a variable. So the variable SHDR, it contains an array which is mapped in this file. So you can query how many elements you have. Oops, length. Okay, let me put the output in decimal, which is gonna be better. Yeah, 11. So we have 11 sections. Now, what sections are we looking for? Okay, we are looking for the section containing some relocation that we want to corrupt, basically. How do we know which section we want? Okay, we could do it by name, right? Or by flags, in the flags of the section. Let's do it by name. We have an array of 11 sections. Well, poke, again, it gives you a full programming language. So you can do things like this, for example, for s in this array, right? You can do print whatever is the name of the section concatenated by new line. How do you get the name of a section in ELF? This is all very inconvenient, but object formats, binary formats are like this often. Well, basically in an SHDR, for example, let's take the third one, there is a field which is shname, but shname is not a null terminated string. It is an offset into a string table which is in the ELF object. And which string table? Well, it is one string table, because an ELF object can have more than one string table, that is linked from the ELF header. So the ELF pickle in poke provides you a very nice function, which is this ELF string, that given an ELF header and an offset, then optionally you can specify an alternative string table, then it gives you the string, doing a mapping internally. Okay, so basically we can use ELF string, then we pass the ELF header, and then we pass the second shname. Oh, it's dot data. It's not the one we are looking for. How can we find which one we are looking for? Well, you could do something like for s in for each section header, we can print the ELF string of EHDR and s.ehname plus new line. And then we find out that, oh, okay, so we are interested probably in this rela section, right? Which should have some relocation. So it is the eighth. Oops, the eighth. There you go. Now, given a section header, we need the relocations which are stored in this section, right? How do we know how an ELF section header describes the area in the file that it is describing? Well, you have an sh off offset, which is the offset in the file where the section starts, and then you have a sh size, which is the length in bytes of the section, of the contents. Okay, but what are the contents of this section? Relocation. So of course we have here the definition of a poke struct that reflects a relocation. Okay, so now what we want to do? To map an array of relocations, which are the relocations stored in that section. Okay, so ELF64 rela, we want to map an array of relocations at what offset? How many relocations? Yeah, well, the thing is that this is also common in object files and in binary formats. ELF section can contain different kind of information, of entities. So the section header is generic. It is telling you how big is the section in bytes. So you will need to take the size of a single relocation and, you know, divide, and then you get, you know, the number of relocations in the section. But Poke can do better than that. And instead of number of elements, you can have, I will explain this more later, you can add, you can specify a size when you map an array and you have an array type. Which basically this is map whatever relocations fit in SH size. Oops. L64. Ah, there you go. This could not go that smoothly, of course. Okay, so this is an array, right? And it contains only one relocation. So we index it, def bar rela. Okay, so now rela is our relocation. Look, beautiful. Now let's vandalize it. Attend two. And then, yeah, okay, this is weird. I don't know why. then we exit, and then we do a readelf minus r foo.o, and look at the addend, two. So mission accomplished, okay? And we managed to do this in a few minutes using 100 lines of some structs and a function that they can reuse again and again and again and again. And in a way that Poke is totally and completely independent for, in this case, the ELF format. So this was my goal, right? So back to the talk. Right. No, I'm not done. Now is the boring stuff. So you have seen that Poke uses a programming language of itself. It is a domain-specific language. I am a compiler's guy, so I fix everything with a compiler. I don't know. So this language is very, very, very straightforward in most aspects, but it has two or three very specific design decisions, which are the domain-specific part of it. So the language has values. You can have integers, 10, FF, whatever. You have null terminated strings, which are native types. You have arrays, not multidimensional arrays, because you can have arrays of arrays. And then, of course, you have structs. I know poor Knut, he is not 100 years old, but I hope he will be at some point. And then we get to the first special thing in the Poke language. You have observed that in the demo, I was talking about offsets, and I was using, like, to send 24 bytes, for example, it was saying 24 hash B, right? Why? Because when I was designing Poke, I had a first dilemma, which was, I'm going to make it byte-oriented or bit-oriented, right? Why? Because if I make it byte-oriented, then 96% of the people will be very happy with it, but there will be 4% of people hacking bit-oriented formats, like difflet, for example, who are going to hate my guts very much. Because my answer to that people will be, I'm sorry, you cannot use Poke for your bit-oriented structs. Then I was like, no, I should be more generic. But if I do it bit-oriented, meaning that if the program, every size and every offset you specify it in bits, well, I mean, your ALU will explode, you know, multiplying by 8 and, you know, shifting to the left, right? It would be horrible, right, to operate in bits all the time. Solution, units. So in Poke, you have a primitive kind of value, like the integer or the string, which I call offsets. They are called offsets because in Poke, usually you edit files, you know, and the sizes are used to refer to offsets of things in the file. But they are also used for sizes. So basically, an offset is a magnitude, like 8 there, plus a unit. In this case here, the first one is 8 bits. The second one is 23 bytes, and the third one is 2 kilobytes. But then I thought, well, I mean, this is nice, but it's too constrained, you know, to have only bit, bytes, kilobytes, megabytes. Because I get distracted easily and I can forget to include the unit that you want. So I said, OK, let's make it generic. So basically, you, as the unit, you can specify the multiple of the basic unit, which is one bit. So for example, there, the first one is eight entities of 8 bits each, and the second is 2 entities of 3 bits each. But then it was like, yeah, but if I can't work in terms of bits and bytes and kilobytes, why can't I work in terms of packets, relocations, MP3 tags, whatever? So then I was like, let's allow in POKE to specify any type whose size can be inferred at compile time as a unit. So for example, there, 23 packets, which is whatever it is in bytes or bits or whatever. You see? It's generalized, and it's very, very, very comfy. I can tell you that. So I have a little algebra of offsets there. So what happens if you add an offset to another offset? What do you get? An offset, right? 1 byte plus 1 byte, 2 bytes, fine. What happens if you multiply an offset by a scalar? What do you get? Another offset with the same unit. This is like doing physics, right? What do you get if you divide an offset by another offset? You get an integer. Although this is a bit cheating, but yeah. And then you get the modulus, which is also an offset. Obviously, you don't have offset multiplied by offset because at least up to today, you know, memory is linear. So you don't have, you know, bytes to the, to, you know, a square. No, not yet. Maybe at some point, but yeah. So basically this, along with a very carefully designed syntax, allows you to think, when you use POKE, in terms of units. And of course, it allows you to not mix potatoes with oranges, for example. But also, it has a very nice feeling. For example, if I define a type packet, like the one I defined before, int I long L, and I want to know how many bytes is in one packet, is in 23 packets, in a normal programming language, you need something like size of or whatever. In POKE, you can say, OK, 23 packets. In bytes, OK, let's go to decimal. So there are 276 bytes in one packet. The POKE language allows you to omit the magnitude if it is one. And I did this in purpose. So you can use this very, very familiar syntax when you do operations with offsets. You see? This is nice when it comes, you know, to operate in terms of other things, abstractions, which are not bits and bytes. Anyway, also it has another advantage, which is that that is the type definition specification for an offset type in POKE. Basically, it's telling you that in an ELF header, in an ELF section header, the SH field is a field that is an offset in bytes. So if you were using C or any other programming language to do stuff with section headers, you have always to remember that the unit of that offset is bytes. And that's not always that case, because in so many object formats and binary formats, you speak in terms of entities, not in terms of bytes, right? So that means that every time you are editing and you are assigning stuff to the SH size, you have to remember that the unit is bytes. So you have to do the conversions, you know, and so on. In POKE, you can do an assignment like that, and POKE knows the unit of the right side and the unit of the left side, and it does the right thing for you. Now, that was values. Let's go with the types. In POKE, you have integral types. That is how you denote them. Signed integers and unsigned integers. That n, right now, can be any number from 1 to 64. Now I plan to extend it from 1 to infinite using the multi-precision library internally. This means that, unlike in most programming languages, in POKE you can actually have integers of 3 bytes, of three bits, of 3 bytes or whatever. All right? And you can operate with them exactly the same way that you will operate with a 32-bit integer, for example. Also, POKE is designed in a way that what you POKE is what you get, right? So there is no padding, there is no alignment, there is no nothing. Then offsets, we have seen now, are also first-class citizen values in POKE. like integers. So they have their own type. And there is only one string type, which is any string type. Then the arrays. You can have three different kind of array types. The first one is what I call unbounded, which is any number of integers, right? Or any number of arrays of integers of any number of integers. The second one we have seen in the demo is that you can define a type array types, you know, to have a number, some predefined number of elements. For example, two integers. And it doesn't have to be constant. You can do foo plus var integers, foo and var being variables. But also, and this is what we saw in the demo, you can also bound by size. So how POC knows when you are bounded by number of elements or how, when you are bounded by binding by size? Well, if you specify a magnitude, normal integer, you are binding by number of elements. If you specify an offset value, like in this case 8 bytes, then you are binding by size. So the array type using this bounded by size here and bounded by number of elements, they both have the same number of integers, but the bound is different. And then, well, we have the queen of POC, which is the struct, right? And then I will go fast, you know, because, yeah, it supports, it's nice, but I don't want to bore you. Well, basically, you have a simple struct, right, which is one field after the other. The offset in the IOS, what I call the IOS space, which is the file you are editing. So after 1 byte, which is a magic number, immediately follows a data length, which is a 32 bits unsigned integer, and immediately follows an array of bytes whose size depends on the previous field. So you can see that you can make one field depending on the previous field. Actually, the struct definitions are lexically scoped too, like the functions, which is, you can do fun stuff with that. Also, you can pass arguments to the struct. This is not implemented yet. So you can basically pass, and it is lexically scoped. So basically, every time you create a struct, you create a closure. Also, you can have labels. I have said that by default, each field immediately follows the previous field in the IO space. But sometimes it's common that one field specifies where another field starts, you know, since the beginning of the struct. For that, you can use this syntax at data offset in this case. And basically, what you specify is an expression that evaluates to an offset. Now, this syntax is horrible, I know. I wanted to use like the C, normal C label syntax, which is a prefix, the label, you know, the expression and a colon. But to do that, they have to get rid of the Bison parser and switch to a recursive descent, which I will do now that the language is more or less stabilized. So the syntax will change, but it is just a syntax word. I'm sorry about that. So also you can have pinned structs, which are like C unions, right? So for example, in this pinned struct, it describes the following layout. It describes a 32-bit stinfo, and then or, you know, an stbind and sttype, one is 28 bits and the other one is 4 bits. It's like a C union. And then you may wonder, why do you did not use union for this? Because unions in POC are something else. And this is something I got from data script, and it is pure genius from the data script designer. Basically, you have seen that when in a POC struct, when you define a struct in POC, you are basically implicitly defining a decoding algorithm, right? Because that is what all POC is about. I mean, if with a normal programming language, if you want to edit something in a file, you have to decode, then you compute, and then you encode again, right? POC, the goal of the program is to do the first and the last phase for you, the decoding and encoding. So sometimes you need to express conditionals in the decoding process, because it is very common for object formats that what follows, what comes next, depends on what you have read already, right? So this is an example. This is the POC description of a subset of it, of an MP3 frame tag. You know, this is what is used in MP3 files internally to store the artist name, the gender, and so on. You can see that an 83b2 frame starts with an array of 4 characters, but the first character cannot be 0. That is a constraint that I mentioned before in that field. And then you have a size. Then you have other stuff. And then you have either the first union there or an array of size characters, which is called frame data. Depending on what? Depending on the constraints of the different branches of the union. If size, which is a field read before, is bigger than, if the ID 0, the first character in ID, is T, then what do you have? Again, depends, it's another union. You can have either that struct or another array of size. Now, how does this work? Which one, what is the alternative that is taken by POKE? Okay, it is the first union entry for which no constraints are violated while decoding. I know it takes a little bit to get into it, but really, once you do, it's very, very nice, you know, way of expressing it. So you may wonder what is the difference from that of that frame data and the previous one. Well, the difference is that the frame data at the bottom is the option that is taken if ID 0 is not T, is not big T. And the other one is taken if the ID 0 is T and size is not bigger than 1. You see? That's how you express your conditionals. This way of working, and this is that's why I say it's pure genius of the guy who designed that script, is that this allows you to define the data in a very similar way, almost a literal translation to the specification, how the format is specified. So there are constraints. We have seen the constraints, which are very important in POKE. Now, the language, of course, it has other stuff, like, for example, I support polymorphic types, so you can write functions that operate on generic things. At the moment, the way I'm using to implement polymorphism is what I call a poor man's polymorphism support, but eventually I want to transition into gradual typing. So you can write your POKE code to make it as more or less generic, which means as less or more efficient, depending on what you want to do with that code. Because I know that POKE is going to be used in file systems, you know, and in big volumes of data. So it is very important for the user to have some control on how fast your code will run. So if you want very generic code but slower, you use more generic types. If you want faster, then you have to pay for flexibility, of course, right? Then, of course, the language, it has variables. Yeah, nothing strange here. It is lexically scoped, meaning that the functions are closures. Well, the mapping. We saw before during the demo that in POKE, what you do mostly is to map stuff, right? And this is the central idea of the program, and this is what took me so long to get it right. It's not that the program is so difficult, it's maybe that I am too stupid, or a combination of both, I don't know. Depending on how caritative you want to be. But what is a very central idea of POKE? In POKE, you can have an array, like def bar, an array of 3 integers. It's an array. You can refer to the elements. You can assign to them. You can pass them to other functions. It's OK. And it works. But also, you can map an array. For example, an array of 3 integers at the offset 0. Oh, I don't have a file. OK. So A is an array of 3 integers. B is an array of 3 integers. What is the difference? Well, from the language perspective, as less different as possible, meaning A is mapped, no, B is mapped, yes. So B is mapped, so it has an offset. Okay, so what is the difference? The difference is that if I assign to the first element of A, the update only happens, let's say, in memory, right? In the memory where you have your POKE variables. But if I do the same with B, then it is reflected in the file that you are editing. So in POC, you can work quite transparently with both mapped and not mapped values. And this is what I wanted. This is what I wanted. Why? Because in POC, you can write, for example, code like this. And before you say anything, I know that my POC is terrible, but I mean, what can I say? I'm new. So you can write a quick sort function in POC with a comparator and whatever, using, you know, this any, this polymorphism stuff. Now, what happens if I pass the array A to quick sort? It sorts the variable in memory. What happens if I pass B? It sorts the bytes, in this case the integers, in the file that I am editing. But I don't have to write a quick sort for one and a quick sort for the other. It is transparent, which is the whole idea of this. It actually works, eh? So, the mapping we have seen, you can map simple types, you know, like integers, you can map arrays, and you can map structs. I can say that when I started this program, my expectation was that, okay, simple elements are easy, arrays are going to be a bit more difficult, but it's going to be a struct which is going to be challenging to implement. The arrays have been very difficult. Also, you have functions. This is a function, for example, that given a CTF, an ELF header, it's returning you, it's giving you the section in the section header of a CTF section in the ELF file, for example. You can pass optional arguments to function by specifying a default value. This is normal stuff, but it is lexically scoped, which is interesting, meaning that the value of the initialization gets captured in the closure. It supports variable length arguments, right, using arrays of any. I happen to like ALGOL 68 very much, and I don't care if you like it too, but I do. And since this is my language, I implemented some ALGOL 68-isms. And my favorite, for example, is that in ALGOL 68, you can have, if a function doesn't get any number of arguments, you can just name it by name, like if it was sort of a variable. So in POC, it supports it. Hmm? OK, this was the first part of the talk. And we are almost over in the time. And then I wanted to show you the architecture, because it's fun, but there is no time. So I will rush over it very, very fast. So this is the overall architecture. You have a command module, which is, you know, the boring stuff, read line, you know, stuff like that. Then you have a compiler that compiles POC into a virtual machine that they designed, which is the PVM, which is the POC virtual machine. And then you have the IO space, which is the module that gives you access to the file you are editing. This is a disassembly using a POC command, which is, I have a disassembler. This is a disassembly of the expression there in the assembler of the POC virtual machine. It is a stack machine, because I like stack machines. And please, oh, I know the prolog is bulky and the plog is bulky, but I don't know what you mean. What is BPF? This is not a BPF talk.
Just so you know.
No, mic for this.
He wrote the GCC backend for BPF.
Oh. Come back to POC and the awesome compiler. It is not a Mickey Mouse compiler, meaning that it has passes, fuzzes, you know, and optimization. It has constant folding and stuff. All right? That is what I wanted to say. Also, I made a macro assembler because I was going crazy writing, you know, the code generator by hand. And also, I was getting even more crazy, so then I wrote something called RAS, which means it's the retarded POC assembler, which is implemented in a AWK program, And it allows me to write the bulk of the code generator and the runtime like using like a proper this. So then I have a virtual machine. For that I am using Jitter, which is sort of an infrastructure for writing interpreters, which is very nice. It was written by my friend Luca, and you can find it there in aginghacker.net. And well, it has a big instruction set, which is very similar to fourth, yeah. Then the IO subsystem. If we go back to the overall architecture, where is it? No. Here, you will find something, which is that the IO system is not connected to the command nor to the compiler. Well, obviously not to the compiler, but not to the command. It is connected to the PVM. Why? Because the way that you do IO, the implementation handles, you know, the writing bytes or reading bytes from the file you are editing, is all done through instructions in the virtual machine, which are called pick and poke. And this means that it is basically the assembler program that you compile that does the IO, right? And I think this is a very powerful abstraction, because basically this IO thing is translating from an, a space of IO objects, which is, for example, a 3-bits integer, into an space of bytes. Well, the space of bytes, it could be a file, which is what is implemented. It could be based on ptrace for a process memory. It's not implemented yet, but says welcome. Or it could be a file system, or anything that can support, you know, seek, pick, get C, and put C. That's the idea. Now, in this abstraction implementation, of course, we are already implementing transactions, rollback, you know, like callbacks, you know, so you, when you update, because what they want to do with poke is to be able to remove a relocation, for example, and then all the offsets around automatically click, 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 updating. That's a dream made true, right? I don't know if we will manage to do that, but we will try. And then, very fast, because this is something I'm actually sort of proud of. Tools, interactive tools, they have a problem, which is that they need a language to be commanded. Now, in the case of poke, I took great pains to design a good domain-specific language to poke structs and to do things like that. But then, of course, poke also has an interactive interface. So then I was like, well, what should I do here? I mean, should do I the traditional way, which is to give you an excellent DSL and a totally shitty command language? Or what? So then, basically, I decided to introduce an alternative syntax that you can use when calling functions, which is like that. For example, this is a function that gets three integers, one of which is it has a default value. So you can call it using the normal syntax foo parentheses 10, 20, 40, but also you can call it using this alternative syntax, which, yes, totally looks like Common Lisp. I also like Common Lisp. Where you can specify the parameters to the function by name first, and also you don't have to specify the ones that has a default value second, and also you can specify them in any order that you want, third. So with this, you can define new poke commands just defining poke functions. So for example, this is the real prototype of the dump command in poke is written in poke itself, right? And you can achieve this comfy interface, like for example here we had B, which was mapped. Oh, I want to dump B's bytes. Okay, you can do dump from B offset, B size. Ah, there you go. But you can specify the size first and the from later. You know, it gives you, you know, this sort of nice command language, but you can extend poke automatically Just define a poke function, provide the initial values for your function parameters, and you get it. So I don't need a command language. Pickles. Well, what I call pickle, the poke language is called poke with big P, but it's pronounced the same, obviously. And but what I call pickles is like is PK files containing poke code, which are on the same, let's say, domain. Like elf.pk is a pickle for editing elf files. But you could have a pickles for disassemblers or for analyzing TCP packets, for example. It would be called tcp.pk. Probably we will have to introduce some kind of module system, but I never rush. I mean, first get into trouble, then fix it, right? So I'm not going to introduce a module system unless someone complains about it. Okay, this was the elf pickle that we have seen. I have a test suite, and I mean, it doesn't look that bad. What works? What you have seen in the demo today, and well, only files are supported. I only have one command, which is dump, but you can write your own commands, and please send them to me if you do. I will incorporate them in the distro. There is a lot of stuff to do before the first release. I have to say that I was too optimist, and I wanted to come here with a much more mature poke, but BPF happened. I mean, what can I say? Another stuff. And so this is what we will do. I will do before the first release. And then after the first release, well, a lot. I have a long, long file, you know, with to-dos. The project is hosted in my homepage. Also, we have a mailing list. We are in the IRC channel as well. And then finally, well, there is a file called hacking in the source distribution, which I took the work to write. So I would appreciate if people read it. I mean, it's not just your typical hacking that is useless. It contains really useful information. So please read it if you want to hack poke. And I can tell you that it is very fun to hack. And I mean, yeah, join me. And use it if you find it useful. And if you write poke pickles, please send them to me. OK? And I'm pretty much done. Unless you have any question.
Two quick comments. It's really awesome. I love this. The first one is that I would like to be able to work on core files with this. Core files,
yeah.
Yes. I understand that it is possible by describing the core file format, but it would take ages to me. Maybe it could be ported into GDB, for example, because I consider that a debugger is not the right way to work on a dev process.
So yes, I have good news for you. I was in the cauldron last week, and I am already working with the GDB maintainer. Well, we talked about integrating poke in GDB. So GDB will translate out, will make poke aware of the DWARF structs, you know, the DWARF information straight away to poke. So you can poke your memory, yes.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
And the second one, which is very quick, I saw that the command that you type the most is dev var, and maybe you should make it implicit. You should think about improving your language so that, by definition, you
that's an interesting suggestion. I used to write Ada in my previous job, so you can that should you tell you something why I like variables like this. But yeah, I get it. Yeah, thank you for the suggestion.
I have a completion feature, a bit like command completion features, and you can tab it.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
Just brainstorm.
Thanks for your work, it's really great. Do you plan to be able to load KTi formats to description language?
I was made aware of that.
Yeah.
Basically, that is an infrastructure for writing encoders, right? And they happen to have a huge collection of format descriptions. And for me, you know, that is like, yeah, of course, count on it. I will translate them all to poke. Yeah.
Great.
Yeah.
architectures, we have different size for an integer.
Yes.
Do you write to different bulk files or not?
Well, as soon when we have arguments for the structs, probably we will be able to parameterize that. Actually, the plan is that you can, because structs are actually functions internally. So you can have local variables, you can have local functions. You can describe pretty printers, things like that. I mean, the possibilities are infinite and fun. For example, someone asked me recently, have you ever tried to do mapping in a constraint? And I have never tried, I don't know what will happen if you do that, to be honest.
I have a question with regards to constraints.
Yes.
Where did you put them at the end of the unions? Because when you're reading, you have to go back to the end of a definition to understand if...
Unions, yeah.
For readers, maybe for parsing it's easier, but...
Yes, this is a good question, actually, and I thought about this, too. I will probably introduce some syntactic sugar. Actually, there is one syntactic sugar, which is used in data script. I have not implemented that yet. But basically, it is that you can have in a struct, you can have a field, and you can say something like if whatever expression, then you define, you know, your field. This is syntax sugar for a union with an empty alternative,
okay.
Right? So yes, I thought about it. Yeah, to have some sort of syntax sugar, so to make it more readable. Yeah.
You showed the optional arguments on functions.
Yes.
Can you show it again?
Yes. In which function? In dump, for example?
The one with the default values. Yeah, with default values, optional arguments.
Okay. This, for example?
I think it's B for the second line. Yeah, we call it full.
Okay. Okay, well, thank you. I will correct the slide, yes.
Please, don't wait for all your to-do list to be completed before doing 1.0. Fix yourself a deadline.
I know. I will finish the first, I will write a little manual because right now this talk and the other talks I'm doing are the only source for actually what constitutes, an implementation. And I will release as soon as possible, yes.
Even if you don't finish, once you have your first release, you get a lot more contributions. So these ones could help you finish faster, in fact.
Yes, and actually, I'm allergic to vaporware. That's why when I make a new program, I wait on it, not telling anyone for a couple of years, and only when it's does useful things, I share. Because I don't like to make people to waste their time.
It's already not vaporware, in my opinion.
Yeah.
There's a lot of value.
This?
Yes.
Well, I'm happy that you say that. Well, hey, he could have said, yeah, this is useless. Go away. Any other question? Yes.
How do you define field alignment in the structure?
I have ideas. It's not implemented yet, but I want to define alignment because I think it's important, for example, when it comes to search for stuff. One of the purpose of POC is to do reverse engineering, which is to gradually discover the extract of the data that you want to make sense of. For that, searching is super important. And actually, what you want to do is to introduce parallelism at the POC virtual machine level, at the instruction level in the virtual machine. And for exploiting parallelism in searching structs, alignment is fundamental. Also for lazy evaluation, right? So yes, I don't know, I have ideas. Subscribe to the mailing list if you have suggestions, and we can discuss it there. There is a lot to decide too. still. Last one.
Could you embed? Sorry, could you embed a poke into, like, as a library into the project? For example, if you want to write some kind of, if you want to write signature to detect some like kind of bad files or that exploit things, you first have to parse them, obviously, and you have a nice framework to parse files. But then you want to use other tools or other things to like get values and compares to list of bad things or something like that.
No, don't put poke in the kernel. No, please, no. Don't do
it.
I promise it's full of memory overflows and everything. You cannot touch it. Okay, well, what can I say? Yeah, sure. Well, do it.
Yeah, I just heard about Indian Nest question. And
yes.
On top of that, my question was about text encoding. Do you plan to use, for example, UTF-32?
Yes, there is one thing I want to add. It's support for wide strings and wide chars.
Okay.
You know, like in C, it's using the same syntax. Yeah.
Okay.
And for NDNS, I support little, big, and PDP NDN. And also, this is not implemented, but it's supporting two complement negative encoding and one complement negative encoding.
BCD as well.
There you go. Okay, we have to stop here. Thank you.